What was your most traumatic experience from youth to where you are today that brought you to writing the book, Good Morning, I Love You?
Yeah, so when I was a teenager, I had scoliosis, and kind of out of the blue, it became so severe that my spine was going to puncture my lungs. And so I had to
Oh.
have emergency surgery. I had a metal rod put in my spine. So I went from this kind of active, healthy teenager 1 week to a week later, lying in a hospital bed, unable to walk.
Oh my gosh. And you were in high
I was
school.
17. Yeah, I was in high school.
17. And I remember playing volleyball. So you were ready to go off to college and.
Right. So I had just signed to play at Duke University, and volleyball was my entire life, and all of a sudden it was gone. As a teenager, I just didn't have the tools to cope. And I'm so grateful to my father. He gave me this book on mindfulness. I remember it so clearly. I was lying in that hospital bed, and he came in with this real tender fatherly concern and handed me this book. And I remember the first line of the book. It says, "No matter what has happened to you, it's already happened. The real question is now what?"
Now
And
what?
I felt like this world opened up, like this possibility that I could be happy again, that I could have a life, maybe not the life I planned, but still a wonderful life. And it led me on this, lifelong journey. Once I recovered a few years later, I went to Nepal and Thailand and studied in monasteries and felt such deep transformation in my own life, both physically in terms of my physical pain, but also emotionally and mentally, that when I came back to the US, I decided to get my PhD and study mindfulness scientifically and eventually became a professor. And I've spent the last 20 years studying. Yeah. And
Great. So you're a professor, and where do you teach today?
I'm at Santa Clara University in California. And
Great.
I've been there for 17 years. I did a postdoc at Stanford, and the very next day I started as a professor. So
That's
it's
amazing.
the only world I've ever known. Yeah.
That is wonderful. Wow. So you turned tragedy and self. What we put into ourselves when we are faced with fear and hurt and pain, whether it's traumatic of an accident or we're born with something specific or life in general of just dealing with everyday stresses. And you took it and found yourself through Nepal. Is that where you really feel like you found yourself when you were visiting Nepal?
So present. And then spending time in the monasteries was really where I had this incredible epiphany. One of the monks said to me, I was there for 2 weeks in silence doing a meditation retreat, and I was getting so frustrated with myself because I felt like I wasn't doing it right and I just couldn't do it. And my mind was all over the place. And I thought I was going to be peaceful and zen, and it was far from it. And I remember telling this monk about my frustrations and my judgments and my impatience. And he looked at me and he said, "You're not practicing mindfulness. You're practicing judgment, impatience, frustration."
Ah.
And he said these 5 words. He said, "What you practice grows stronger. What you practice grows stronger." We know this now with neuroplasticity. Our
Yeah.
repeated thoughts, our emotions, they shape our brain. And so it radically shifted the whole way I approached mindfulness, that meditation became a place to practice kindness instead of judgment, a place to practice peace instead of rushing.
Exactly. Yes. I'm intentional on mindfulness and meditation and moving forward during these stressful moments in our lives, especially now with the coronavirus and people being fearful and unknowing.
Yeah.
Don't
Yeah.
have to have a disease. Everyone's kind of feeling that right now of how you felt before you had your surgery, how I felt. Finding out I had MS, but we both turned it around. So, what would be key things that you could share with us today, moving forward, to someone that is 100% perfectly healthy and nothing wrong, but they're feeling all of this
Yeah.
emotions of everything we went through?
Exactly. Well, I think what you're saying is exactly right, which is all of us are experiencing the stress of these times. We're experiencing it in our nervous system, in our hearts. And it's so important to learn practices that can grow resilience and resources in us. And so, a couple of very small tips. The first is just to name how you're feeling. You know, mm-hmm. that's so radical. It's so simple, but it's so radical just to be like, sweetheart, it's really scary right now, or you're afraid, or you're feeling lonely. Just saying that, what science shows, this was a study from UCLA, is that when we name our emotions, it downregulates the nervous system, it calms down our physiology, and then we can meet them with greater clarity and wisdom. So the first step, just name it to tame it, right? Just name the emotion.
I love that. Name it to.
So what happens is we skip to what am I going to do next? And we don't first just say, sweetheart, it's scary right now. This is okay. overwhelming. And so the first step is really to pause and really honor our emotions. And then the second step is to be kind to ourselves. Right, let me give you a hug.
Yes.
And we don't do that for ourselves. Instead, we beat ourselves up and we're like, you're not doing enough. What's wrong with you? And keep us stuck in the very behaviors we want to change. They don't help us. They don't help you become a better person. You know, what I tell people is if beating yourself up worked, I would say, go ahead and do it. If it's going to make you a better mother or if it's going to make you happier, it doesn't work. What's interesting is that kindness and compassion actually turn on the learning centers of the brain. They give us the resources we need to change.
I always have this morning routine of I walk, get up, whether I'm in pain or not, and I move to it, but I always look in the mirror and I always say, I love you. And today we're going to accomplish, I have a list of five and I name those five things. But I always say, if we get one done, we did great today. And I got it done and I tap myself on the back.
That is so healthy and so abnormal. You're kind of the anomaly, Dawn, because most of us go around and we say, oh, I didn't do it or something's wrong with me. So what you're doing is so helpful because when we learn how to treat ourselves with kindness, it actually allows us to be more effective, more productive, mm-hmm. and more generous with other people. So a lot of times people think kindness is selfish. It's the opposite. It's actually learning how to be a better citizen of the world.
Today was the most powerful movement in your life while you were writing the book.
Mm, gosh, it's so interesting. No one has asked me that. This is probably the 500th interview I've done since it came out in the last 3 months.
No one asked you this?
pardon? No one has asked me that. And the second you said it, I knew the answer. So, gosh, it's such a strange one. When I was writing the book, I was really remembering back to the surgery because I've completely blocked that part of my life out. Okay. And I had this realization that, of course, I couldn't walk up and down. My parents have, my sweet father gave up his entire, you know, bedroom and air and living space for me to rehabilitate. Yeah. And I had kind of put that. So I was in the middle of writing and I put down everything. I called my dad and I was like, I love you so much. Thank you so much. And it was one of those just very unexpected special moments. So I don't even know if that's relevant, but it's what came to mind. It's
completely relevant because that's what drew you to continue your purpose to write the book. And your book today has helped thousands, millions possibly around the world. When you Google your name, you are everywhere for mindfulness and finding your inner peace and moving forward in your life. And that is not only an art, it is such a spiritual enlightenment of a gift that you are sharing with the world. And when we first started talking and we FaceTimed each other for the very first time, I could just see it radiating from you. And I truly believe sometimes tragedy brings us to the best light of our lives and to move forward.
Absolutely. In fact, in Chinese, the word for crisis means both danger and opportunity. And I think it's all about how we meet it. And I think for me, that's why I wrote the book is when I did my TED Talk 2 years ago, I shared this Good Morning, I Love You practice, which for me was this very personal, intimate, kind of awkward and embarrassing practice. And, you know, it went viral. It has over 1.5 million views.
I know.
People really resonated with it. And I realized all of us struggle with shame. All of us struggle with self-doubt and we're not good enough. And that these practices, they're simple, but they're important. Like they need to be practiced every day. And I love that you get up in front of a mirror and say, I love you. I still don't do that. I lie in bed and I put my hand on my heart. And, you know, some days still I say, good morning, I love you. And it feels awkward. you know, and other days it feels beautiful and this deep spiritual love, but it's this continual practice. And I think that's what I like people to know, is that it's never too late, right? You've never messed up so badly, or your current circumstances are never too, you know, too severe that you can't change. That change is possible for all of us, no matter what.
No matter what.
It's what neuroscience teaches us. Yes. We're never stuck.
That is so true. And I know that I have done so much research, and I believe I shared with you that I'm constantly retraining my brain.
Yes.
Living with multiple sclerosis, I now can tell you when I'm going to have an attack by how my body is acting and what is moving forward. So I literally move forward every day with, if my brain is acting up over here and my side of my face is coming down, or I can't feel my hand, I will go to the left side of my body and start moving the left side. So the brain is like, wait a minute, what is she doing? What is going on? And it's almost kind of like taking a shaking ball at Christmas and you shake it up and snowflakes just start going. I constantly am like re-tapping and retraining my brain and reading.
What you're saying is so important, which is you're able to see clearly what's needed and then respond effectively and wisely. The word mindfulness means to see clearly. So we need to see clearly each moment so we know how to respond. And for you, it's with MS and your physical body. For other people, it's the stressors of life. And that's why mindfulness, it's such a powerful tool, because it makes us resilient. Whatever comes, we see it clearly. We have the tools to respond.
With anyone today watching this show, mindfulness, how I've done my mindfulness, how you learned good morning, I love you, Shauna, with on your hand. It really doesn't matter where we are in our day. We can practice this constantly, correct?
Exactly. In fact, that's the whole thing. And you can practice moment by moment. In fact, every moment matters. Every moment you are changing your brain. And so throughout your day, I always put my hand on my heart. My son gets so embarrassed, but it soothes me, and it reminds me to be gentle with myself instead of constantly pushing.
Yeah. What is going on that you can't stay in this mindset? And I try to analyze it and move forward.
I think what you're saying is so important, which is you can begin again in any moment. So let's say you've pushed yourself too hard that day. The antidote is not to beat yourself up and be like, why did you push yourself so hard? You're terrible. But to say, oh, sweetheart, what can we learn? And I'm going to begin again in this moment. This moment is new. It's never too late. You can begin again, right?
Right. Yes. It's a brand new moment, and a brand new moment to each day coming up. It's constantly moving forward. It's like the ocean tides. They're always rolling out, but they're always rolling back forward. And I believe that we constantly need to just leave that rolling backwards back there and learn and accept and move forward.
Exactly. Yeah. Beautiful. I love the analogy of the ocean, and also just our breath, right? There's that inhale and that exhale, and it's always right here. It's this new, fresh life, oxygenating the body, and then releasing stress and toxins out into the world. And what's beautiful is it's not like you're polluting the world with your out-breath, right? It's carbon dioxide. It's what the trees and the plants need.
Exactly. I tell someone that lives in the big city, what can they find in the big cities today where there's little trees, there's little like those getaway moments? How could they do it at home?
Right. So a couple things. One is nature is an incredible resource. And for those of us lucky enough to be near it, use it and enjoy it. I